Hey everybody, hope you're doing well. Today we're going to examine what an interesting lady named Emma Stark says about gifts and angels. Let's jump right in. Now, if you don't know who Emma Stark is, she's a leader, a prophet, and an author of Global Prophetic Alliance in Glasgow, Scotland. And just to be clear, Emma Stark is in no relation to Tony Stark. This is Emma Stark.
Hi, my name's Emma. I'm a prophet. I hear from God.
That being said, her main focus is on prophecy, although she has some pretty wild stories about angel encounters as well. The first clip we're going to look at is on the Sid Roth show. Now, for most of us, that's a red flag from the start. And if we look on her site, we can see all sorts of merchandise for sale. Maybe it's just me, but I don't know why any church leader needs to be selling coffee cups, scented candles, or clothes. And what's with selling cast iron keys? If this doesn't scream, "Give me your money," I don't know what does. And of course, you can buy her online courses too, even on dealing with angels. And that will be the second video we will review. But first, let's start with the Sid Roth video. I'm not going to play the full vid, but we'll leave a link below.
You said to me that every believer, whether they're 6 years of age or whether they're 96 years of age, if they have never operated in the supernatural or never operated in what is known as words of knowledge or prophecy, you're saying everyone can do this. Not only are you saying it, you equip people to do it.
Oh, totally. And I think we have got to get over our nonsense and our false humility and our low self-esteem that we just continually disqualify ourselves. You know, we're children of the Most High God, and the Word of God is clear. You can all prophesy.
So right from the beginning, she is taking things out of context to support her teaching. In 1 Corinthians, Paul is talking about how we each have different gifts, and some were given the gift of prophecy. But we cannot all prophesy, like she is saying. So if we look at this passage in context, we can see it's talking about order in church meetings. It gives us instruction that only two or three at most should speak in tongues, and it must be one at a time and only with an interpreter. But the verse continues, not saying that all people can prophesy, but that all who had the gift of prophecy should do it in turns, just like those who had the gift of tongues. But to say all can prophesy is to call God a liar, because he spoke through Paul saying that we don't all have the same gifts, and prophecy is just one of them.
You not only operate this way, you not only have equipped thousands to operate this way, but what did you, how you raised your children that when they were little to operate this way?
I mean, they blow my mind. And I think children are so easy to teach.
So once again, you can't equip thousands to operate this way, and you can't teach people either. She goes on to tell stories about training kids, but we'll skip that because it's not true.
It's not just that we've trained them to prophesy. We train them to heal the sick. We train them to cast out demons. And actually, I think that the younger they are, sometimes the better at deliverance they are, because they're in such a purity of faith.
And you can't train people in healing either.
I love it. I'm going to tell you something. Anything that Jessica can do.
Yes.
Anything. Yeah. That you read about or you see on my show, the guests do, you can do better. How would you like Emma to pray a prayer over you and your family to walk in that same power, that same boldness, the same authority that she and her family walks in? Next.
Obviously, Sid has not read and understood his Bible and gifts. And we'll skip over her praying as well. You're welcome. But of course, it wouldn't be Sid Roth if Emma wasn't selling some ridiculous product on how to do something amazing.
Emma, you have the most sensational keys that you teach to walk in the power and prophecy and words of knowledge. Tell me, one or two of these keys.
Oh, some secrets, yes. I think we pray in tongues a lot. And if you don't have the gift of speaking in tongues, you need to ask for it right now as you listen to this. Because tongues is like a motor, like a generator. And the more you speak in tongues, the easier it is to bring a word to the Lord and revelation. But more than that, because Jude says, build yourself up in your most holy faith. The more you pray in, by speaking in tongues, the more you pray in tongues, the more you get built up. It's a faith builder. We actually have evidence that when we get sick or unwell and we pray in tongues, the sickness just disappears like that because of the nature of how that gift starts to build up and establish you in strength. So that's a massive top tip. But the key to this gift, above everything else, is practice. If you don't practice, you will always hit a glass ceiling. It does not matter how much you pray, how much you fast, unless you have got to the place where you put the English language or your language on the moving of the Spirit, then you will always be capped.
I'm really curious where in the Bible it says to practice the gift of tongues. Oh yeah, that's right, it doesn't. And did you catch that last bit? Put the English language or your language on the moving of the Spirit. Well, tongues is speaking in unknown languages, and there's nothing in Scripture that teaches putting your language to the Spirit. I'm just jumping ahead to her explanation of why she practices tongues.
I already had hours of practice tucked under my belt. Now, I am perpetually frustrated with my own prophetic level. I don't know a prophet who ever feels they've arrived. So I practice. I walk my dog in the park and I'm saying to the trees, trees, do you know what God is going to do in this area of Scotland?
So that's right, folks. She's talking to the trees.
I fly in the airplane and I say, do you know what God is going to do over the nation I'm flying over? Why? Because I'm continually in this practice place so that when it matters, when it's a queen, when it's a politician, when it's a UN ambassador, that I have practiced enough to know what God actually thinks in an instant.
I can't find any scripture to back this up. If you practice prophecy enough, you can get to the point where you actually know exactly what God is thinking? Wow. Okay, I think that's enough of Sid Roth, but this next clip is on another Supernatural show, and she's also selling her products on learning how to access the throne room and have angel encounters. But she's gonna, I'm gonna call it for what it is, lie about having the same experience Isaiah had in chapter 6, where a six-winged seraphim angel literally walks through her wall and puts coals on her tongue, just like what happened to Isaiah.
Emma teaches that it's biblically normal to have angelic encounters today, and there's a new paradigm, there's a new pattern of people, Christians, believers, partnering with angels. You got a ton of stories. Now, you talk about it being biblically normal. Let's go to Isaiah 6.
Yes.
Because Isaiah had a wonderful experience, but you have an experience tied in with that.
Well, yes, and this is an Irish accent, and I'm full-blown Celtic warrior, just so you've got the heads up on that.
I'm ready. Yeah.
When I was a teenager and when I was studying at university, I had my first angel encounter, which set me on a trajectory to examine the scriptures to see, well, God, is this okay? Because I just want to be biblically normal. I don't want to be outside a biblical best practice. So I was on my knees praying Isaiah 6, and I was praying that for days, and I would run back from my lectures and say, God, here I am, send me, you know, that devotion of a teenager, you know, oh, I just want you to use me, God. And then this seraphim walked physically through the wall.
Now tell the people at home what a seraphim is, because they don't know.
Well, a seraphim is one of the holiest angels, and it's in that, in fact, it's the only time seraphim is mentioned in scripture is Isaiah 6.
Okay.
And they're the ones that hold the tongs with coals
with the
end.
Right.
And he was terrifying because, of course, they're many winged, and in fact, they're six winged, and very much like Mary who falls down dead, or John in scripture, the Revelator. I was like, if I hadn't been on the floor already, I would have been on the floor.
Right.
So I'm holding the end of my bed sheets in that kind of because the holiness of God has just walked into the room. And this angel said, the Lord has heard your prayers. And he physically put the coal to my lips. And in a second, as an 18-year-old, my entire mouth went totally ulcerated. Wow. And I started to bleed.
Could that have happened? Sure, but not likely. I'm saying liar, liar, pants on fire. And I'm going to let it play out so you can hear the absurdity of this as it links into other lies.
I actually have blood on the pages of that Bible that I was using in my late teenage years. And it was just, it was so shocking. And I was in pain, but I had met physically, not just spiritually, I had met physically with the power and the purification of the Lord. So I mean, I was terrified and I went straight to my minister. I'm like, I don't know what to do, you know, and this would have been in the mid 90s. And he just got some water and blessed it and said, drink it. And as quickly as the burning had come, it went. And so that made me start to say, well, oh God, you know, is this going to be the way life should be? Is this normal?
Right.
So let me give you some biblical numbers. Angels are in scripture 300 times. So they're quite common.
Right.
But 104 of those times, they are interacting, talking to people.
No, this isn't true. There are not 104 different times angels actually talk to people in the Bible. There's only a handful. In the Old Testament, Lot was visited by angels. The angel appeared to Daniel. And there's several mentions of the angel of the Lord visiting people like Hagar, Abraham, Moses, Jacob, Joshua, and Gideon, for example. But the angel of the Lord was different in that many scholars say that it appeared to be God himself, like with Moses and the burning bush. In the New Testament, we see in both Luke and Matthew that Gabriel comes to Joseph. Angels tended Jesus after his 40-day fast. Angels released Peter from captivity. They came to John in prison. What I think she's doing is taking each thing the angel said as a separate encounter, which is once again twisting scripture to make it support what someone wants. She continues to justify this.
So tongues, if I get you to guess how many times tongues is in scripture, speaking in tongues,
it's not a lot.
It's not a lot, yeah. No, 12 to 15. Yeah. Or a Gideon's fleece. I mean, how many times is that?
Yeah.
Once.
Yeah.
And yet we've all laid fleeces before the Lord.
Right.
You know, I don't know what your fleece laying is like. Mine can be a bit daft. Oh God, my hanging baskets are all dead. If you resurrect the flowers and they're all in bloom, you know, I know you have got this task.
Right.
We're all a bit daft
it. What's daft?
Daft, silly.
Silly, okay.
Silly, I'm a bit silly with my fleeces. But the point of it is, tongues is only there half, you know, a dozen times. A fleece there once. Angel interaction 104 times.
Yeah.
It is more biblically normal to interact with an angel than it is to lay out a fleece or speak in tongues.
Now, what is the purpose, the main purpose in God wanting us to interact with angels?
Well, I think Hebrews 1 summates that very well, that angels are ministering spirits sent to minister to the heirs of salvation. Yeah.
So angels are ministering spirits, but that doesn't mean God wants us to interact with them. She's just making all this stuff up to support the sale of her product that we'll see soon.
So let's look at scriptures that say, fix your eyes on the unseen realm.
Right.
Because the seen, all this stuff here, is temporary, but the unseen is eternal.
But that doesn't mean focus on seeing and interacting with angels. This simply means focus on the things of God and not of this world.
So is it a matter of developing our spiritual eyes to see and to discern?
Yes. I think you can ask intelligent questions.
Okay.
You know, where is Jesus in the room? Where are the angels in the room?
What? Where is Jesus in the room? Jesus isn't in the room. The Holy Spirit is in all believers, but Jesus isn't invisibly walking around the room. And if there are angels in the room, what does it have to do with us and our life serving Christ? Here's another clip where she's talking about this.
But then you ask intelligent questions. Jesus, could you show me where you are in the room? Yeah. Jesus, could you show me the angels in the room? And I think when you look at Daniel 7 and you get a pen and you underline the number of times it says, I looked, I asked, I looked again, I focused again.
Daniel was one of the greatest prophets of the Old Testament, having a vision of the end times. She's really good at twisting things to fit her agenda. She says how much Daniel looked again and asked again and focused again. He wasn't consciously looking. It was a dream and vision, and looking is just the process of what he's seeing next. And the verse never once says, I focused, never mind focused again. Of course, Daniel wanted to understand this, but he only asked about it one time in verse 16.
That there's very much a sense that it's not just, oh, you know, I've had this vision oh my goodness, I'm pinned back by the power of God. But that glorious sense of a man teaching us how he's peering and asking and seeking and looking, vitally important part of the journey.
Yet this has nothing to do with God wanting us to interact with angels.
But I mean, I remember going to a church once, and an angel of his presence, he would have been about 60 meters wide. I mean, a vast, vast, and full wings out.
Yeah.
And he was circling over the top of this church, and he was trying to release the presence of God in the church. Mm. And for weeks I would go and he would be there, and he was screeching in unbearable pain because the church did not want the presence of God.
Yikes.
And eventually that angel just had enough and left.
Mm. Emma has to be one of the greatest storytellers I've ever heard, and we'll finish off with one more whopper of a story before we see what this is all leading up to.
So my husband and I and a friend had gone for dinner one night in a restaurant. We'd ordered our meal and we were waiting for it to come to the table. And this ugly, demonic strongman, demon appeared in the restaurant. And I'd seen him before, but this time he was in full-blown warfare mode.
Wow.
He opened his jacket and all his minion demons rolled out.
Wow.
And the restaurant was full of this force of the demonic. So my husband sees my face and he goes, Emma, are you okay? He says, do we need to leave? And I'm like, no, I've ordered my food. We're not leaving now. You know, and how difficult it is to get babysitters sometimes. And
exactly.
I'm like, no,
I'm
going
to eat this meal.
I am staying. So I turned to my guardian angel to say, what's the best plan here?
Right.
But he's a Psalm 91 angel, which is the angels who hide you under their wings.
Mm.
Fast as anything. I don't even have to speak to him. I just turn around. He winks at me. He's so on it. His wings are up. And he covers the three of us at the table. And we become completely physically invisible. I cannot get any waitress's attention. We're waving, I'm shouting, I'm calling. It's like we have ceased to exist.
Whoa.
So in the end, out of utter desperation, I go to the kitchen hatch and say, I've ordered food and I have to serve my own food to the three of us.
Yeah.
End of the night, restaurant is closing. We're the only customers there. The waitresses are mopping the floor. The chairs are upside down on the tables. And it's kind of lockup time. And the demons disappear.
Yeah.
And the Hydra angel goes, oh, puts his wings down.
Yeah.
At that moment, we are suddenly visible. There's a swarm of all the staff. How did you get in here? How long have you been here?
Wow.
Why could we not see you? What's going on? We looked around the restaurant. We made sure it was clear. We locked the front door. You're in our prime seat. And we did not see anybody at that table all night.
That's incredible.
It is. How do you explain that?
Well, you don't explain that because it didn't happen. How about giving us the name of that restaurant and we can try to confirm this fairy tale? And it continues as she gets people excited about angel encounters. And why would she do that?
Don't miss out on getting Emma Stark's powerful brand new book, The Prophetic Warrior, and her audio masterclass package, Hearing and Seeing God, which includes 10 different sessions, plus her special audio teaching, teaching children to receive divine guidance. This is an exclusive offer for our supernatural audience. Yours for a donation of $29. Shipping and handling is included.
Yeah, I won't bore you with the whole presentation, but it's always about the money. The Bible does speak about ministering spirits, as she mentioned in Hebrews 1:14, and there is an implication that angels are looking out for people in Matthew 18:10. This is where the concept of guardian angels comes from. But once again, this has nothing to do with encouraging interaction with angels. These are the very people spoken of in 2 Peter 2:3. In their greed, these teachers will exploit you with fabricated stories. I've never heard of her until I saw her teaching with Winnie and Georgie and Banoff. And then Carrie Murrell sent me these clips. So thank you for that, Carrie. But we'll leave it here for today. As always, please leave your thoughts and comments below, and until next time, take care and God bless.